Good morning. Glad to see you here at Farmington Baptist Church. Glad you could join us for the 11 o'clock worship service. And I know we have some visitors here, so make sure you make them feel welcome. For those who couldn't be here, I know a lot of you join us on Facebook Live when you can't be here, if you're traveling or something. Or if you would stand up and help us worship the Lord in song this morning with Soon and Very Soon.
Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Soon and very soon, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. No more dying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. No more crying there, we are going to see the King. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we're going to see the King.
Amen. Good job. Good job. You sound good this morning. Let's continue with Love Lifted Me.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. All my heart to Him I give, ever to Him I'll cling. In His blessed presence live, ever His praises sing. Love so mighty and so true, merits my soul's best songs. Faithful, loving service to Him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger look above, Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea, billows His will obey. He your Savior wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
Amen. Good job, good job. You can be seated for just a moment. Brother Ben's going to come up and make some announcements for us.
All right, we are glad you're here in the Lord's house today. Hope you're able to pick up a bulletin, find one there in your pews. Lots of things going on in the life of our church. It's that busy time of the year, so you be sure and go through the bulletin and notice all the things going on. We're thankful today after the service. Brother Rayburn and Martha are celebrating their 70th anniversary, having a reception for them. The family is over in the gym from 2 to 4, so everybody's invited to come to that. So you be sure and congratulate them after the service and let them know that you're proud, glad to see all their family that's visiting with them today. So remember that this afternoon. Next Sunday is homecoming. So celebrating the 139th anniversary of Farmington Baptist Church. So that'll be next Sunday. Looking forward to a big day. We'll have a singing at 10 o'clock. So no Sunday school next Sunday. Singing at 10 o'clock. A service with a guest preacher at 11 o'clock. And then a homecoming meal, fellowship meal over in the gym afterwards. So it'll be a great day. So remember that. The church always takes care of the meat and drinks, so you bring just desserts and sides, and we'll have a great time of fellowship after the service is over. So that's next Sunday is homecoming. Always look forward to that. It's been 3 years since we've had homecoming services, so we're looking forward to a great homecoming next Sunday. Remember, this week, Wednesday night, the children and youth are going to Mason Farms. I think that's 6 to 8. You can see Brother Jamie or Miss Heidi if you've got any questions about the details on that. So the corn maze is on Wednesday. On Thursday is the associational meeting there at High Point Baptist Church, so remember that. And then coming up on a trunk or treat and our chili cook-off on October the 29th. We'll have some more information in the bulletin about that next week. It's a great time, so remember trunk or treat. If you can bring some candy by, if you're not able to come, we'll be sure and give that. Great outreach for our church, so any candy donations will be much appreciated over in the gym. You can leave them over in the kitchen. Remember Operation Christmas Child. Lots of you have already brought your shoe boxes in, but bring those shoe boxes. There's plenty of empty ones there in the foyer you can grab, and encourage all of you to fill up a shoe box and get that in, so you can leave those there in the foyer where we're stacking them up at. So remember Operation Christmas Child as well. So lots of things going on in the life of our church. Remember all these announcements. But we're glad you're here this morning. We want to pray and ask the Lord to give us a great service, a good day. This Lord's Day. Brother Logan, we're proud to have you here with us this morning. Won't you pray for us, if you will, brother? Amen. All right.
All right. If you would stand back up and help us to continue to worship the Lord in song, Open the Eyes of My Heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. Holy, holy, holy. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 I want to see you.
Amen. Amen. Good to see you here this morning. Lots of folks we haven't seen in a while, and good to see all the Britton family here this morning. Miss Jessica is going to bring the special for us here in just a moment. Let's finish up with a song called Thy Word.
Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy Word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and I think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet my heart forever is wandering. Jesus, be my guide and hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Amen. You can be seated.
I keep finding myself fighting to avoid the mirror, the mirror. I could use some help cause I don't like what I see here, see here. Do I measure up? Am I good enough? What if I fail? What if I can't do it well? Will they walk away? Will you walk away? Do you think I'm worth it still? But when all I see are the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. Looking through this mess of a heart, you see perfection, perfection. Show me what's behind your eyes. Don't think I can trust in mine when all I see are the flaws. You see perfection, perfection. I learn slowly, but you're teaching me to love myself. Starting to believe you love me like nobody else. Never measure up, but you are my enough. Sometimes I fail, sometimes I can't do it well. If they walk away, you don't walk away. You tell me I'm worth it still. But when all I see are the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. Looking through this mess of a heart, you see perfection, perfection. Show me what's behind your eyes. Don't think I can trust in mine. When all I see are the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. You see perfection. You see perfection. When all I see are the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. Looking through this mess of a heart, you see perfection, perfection. Show me what's behind your eyes. Don't think I can trust in mine. When all I see are the flaws, you see perfection, perfection. You see perfection.
All right. We appreciate Miss Jessica singing for the Lord, Brother Matt playing for. And that song kind of goes along with the message. And so we appreciate that today. We're going to be in the book of Ephesians. Hope you have your Bibles with you. Ephesians chapter number 6, one verse of scripture, verse number 15. Ephesians chapter number 6 and verse number 15. A lot going on in this section of verses, and we're just going to pull out one phrase and chew on that for a few moments this morning. I want us to think about the last part of this verse as we think about peace with God. Peace with God. Ephesians chapter number 6, verse 15, as Paul is talking about the armor of God in battling the devil, the Bible says in Ephesians 6 and verse 15, and your feet shod with the preparation, and notice what it says, of the gospel of peace. Let's go to the Lord in a word of prayer this morning. Father, thank you for this time to study your word. Lord, I pray as we look at it, our thoughts, our focus, our hearts will be upon you and your word. Teach us from the scriptures. I pray you'd encourage us. Lord, I pray you'd help us. Father, we all need peace, God's peace in our life. And I pray we'd find that this morning. Bless this time this morning, and we pray and ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, peace with God. Billy Graham, you may have the book by that title. He released this book, probably his most famous book he's ever written. It was the third book he ever wrote, and Billy Graham released it in 1953, Peace with God. The Korean War was still going on. The Russians had developed their own atomic weapons. There was a lot of uncertainty in the world at that time period. And Billy Graham released this great book, Peace with God. How can a man, how can a woman, a boy or girl have peace with God in their life? And it went through many editions. And finally, I noticed he kind of expanded. He released it a second time in 1984.
So first of all, in 53, then in 1984, and some of you, we can remember the 1980s with the Cold War that was going on still with Russia and Gorbachev. The Berlin Wall was still up. We had the inflation of the 1970s. There was a lot of uncertainty in the world in 1984. A lot of troubles, a lot of sin was coming on the forefront. He released this book and Peace with God. And then I find it just a few years ago, he released it for the third time. No matter what decade, no matter what generation, every person needs to know, how can a man or woman, a boy or girl, have peace with God? We all need peace. The Bible tells us how to have that peace with God. And we're going to stay right here and we're going to look throughout this chapter, and I want to show you some things that will be a help to us, how we can have peace with God in our life. I want you to see three types of peace. And they all start with the letter S if you're taking notes. I want you to see, number one, the Bible talks about that gospel of peace. I want you to think about, number one, saving peace. How we can have peace with God. Saving peace. I want you to see, number two, though, for the Christian. You say, Brother Ben, I've already been saved. I've already got God's peace in my life. I've been forgiven. I'm a born-again Christian. But not only is there saving peace, there's sustaining peace. Grace that will sustain you. And that's not the first is the peace with God. This is the peace of God. Saving peace, sustaining peace. And then lastly, we want to think about there's a shareable peace. We need to share God's peace with those around us. Let's think about those three things this morning. You notice the last sentence. He speaks, Paul says, your feet shod with your preparation, the readiness of the gospel of peace. Paul is telling us, the Bible is telling us, that the gospel, the good news, the fact that Jesus died and rose again, the good news of Jesus, the gospel will bring you peace in your life. The gospel, Jesus, the story of Christ, will give you peace in your life. We all need that. We need God's peace in our life. Because of sin, because of the fact of who we are, because we've broken God's laws, there is no peace in our life. We must look to Jesus to find peace. You might want to write in the margin here, Isaiah chapter 57 and verse 21. The Bible says in Isaiah 57 and verse 21, there is no peace, saith the Lord, there is no peace to the wicked. Because we have sinned, the Bible says the carnal mind is at enmity, it's hostile with God. Because of our sin, our sins have separated us from God. And because of our sin, there can be no peace in our life. You and I are not born with peace. People say, well, Brother Ben, I've never been saved. And man, my conscience bothers me. I lay down at night and I lay my head on my pillow and I'm troubled. I'm wondering about what I'm going to face one day. Where can I find peace? Because of your sin, there's no peace. There can be no peace. It's like, God is holy. We know that God is holy. He's never sinned. Jesus never sinned. And because of who God is, and because of who you and I are, the two don't mix together. Have you ever tried, and maybe you've done this as a science project, you've mixed oil and water. Well, it don't matter if it's cooking oil or it's motor oil. You mix oil and water together and you can stir it, you can shake it, you can put it in a jar and put the lid on it and shake it for hour after hour. But you let it sit down for a second and that oil and water don't mix together. That's how it is. Because of our sin causes us trouble. Our sin does not mix with who God is. Our sins have separated us from God. How can we find peace with God? How can we have that peace in our hearts? Sin, wickedness, the things, our rebellion against God, we don't have peace. There's a famous phrase in the book of Ezekiel. You may have heard preachers mention it before, where they said the false prophets will say, peace, peace. But there is no peace. And sometimes people will say, sometimes false preachers will say, well, it'll be all right. You just try hard, it'll be all right. You just be sincere. You just do the best you can. You just, try to have your good works outweigh your bad works. You just get baptized. You just join the church. You just take the Lord's Supper. You just put some money in the offering plate, and it'll be all right. But none of those things give us peace with God. The Bible's very clear. The gospel, Jesus, is where we find peace. None of those other things will give you the peace in your heart. We must have that peace. We need that peace. But only Jesus gives us that peace. Paul told us that. If you look back and just turn back one page, maybe two in your Bibles, to chapter 2 of Ephesians. In Ephesians 2 and verse 14, Paul says, "For he, Jesus, is our peace." Ephesians 2 and verse 14. "He is our peace, who hath made both one and broken down the middle wall of partition between us." He says in that verse right before it, verse 13, "But now in Christ Jesus, you who are sometimes far off are made nigh by the blood of Jesus. He is our peace." Jesus is what brings us peace. Now, I know history and I don't know much else. And Brother Scott, you can tell us why the reason for this. But they tell us, I looked this up, they say, if you take that oil and water and you put it in a mason jar, man, you shook it and you stirred it and it still didn't mix. God is holy. You and I, all, every one of us, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The two don't mix. God's holiness and you and I, we all have sinned. Maybe different levels, but the Bible's very clear. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. They don't mix together. Oil and water don't mix. But they tell us, and there's a word for this. They didn't teach it in Todd County. But again, Brother Scott can tell you. He's a biology teacher. But they tell us if you take that oil and water in that mason jar and you take some Dawn dish soap and you squirt it in, that soap does something. You shake it up. That soap will cause that oil and water to come together. It will cause them to merge together. And I want to tell you, the blood of Jesus. Paul says we were a long way off. We were far off, but the blood of Jesus has made us close to God. Jesus has broken down the wall of sin. Jesus is our peace. The only way you'll ever have peace in your life, the only way you'll get rid of the burden, the conviction, the trouble that sin brings, it's not by the church, it's not by the ordinances, the sacraments, the good deeds, the tithes, the offerings, whatever you want to fill in the blank with, the only way you'll ever have peace in your life is through Jesus, through trusting Jesus. He is our peace. There's saving peace. When you trust Jesus, when you cry out in faith and say, "Jesus, I know I've sinned. I know I've messed up. I know I've broken your laws, but I need to be saved. Lord, I want to be saved. I'm asking you to save me." You can have the peace of God, peace with God in your life. So there's saving faith, the gospel of peace, the gospel, the fact that Jesus died on the cross for our sins and rose again the third day, the gospel will bring you peace. So there's saving peace. But I thought it's very interesting, back to our text in Ephesians 5, if you look and read, keep on reading through this chapter, and you come to the very end of the chapter, verse 23, right before the last verse, Ephesians 6 and verse 23, Paul mentions the word peace a second time. He says in Ephesians 6 and verse 23, "Peace be to the brethren and love with faith from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ." Peace be to the brethren. Now this can't be saving faith. The brethren, why do we use that term? The brothers and sisters in Christ. I talk about Brother Jeff down here. We're not literal brothers. We're brothers because of Jesus. There's the family of God, brothers and sisters in Christ. Peace to the brethren. That's not saving peace, but it's sustaining peace. It's not peace with God that comes when you get saved and your sins are forgiven. This is peace with God. You see, we go through this life and we get beat down so much, don't we? I had a lady tell me this, and we were talking about church this very week, and she said, "Brother Ben," she knows I'm a preacher, and she said, "I, you know, through the week at work, I deal with troubles and people are on me and all the mess I deal with. When I come to church on Sunday, I just need a word from God. I need some peace." And that's how it is. We need God's peace. And you see, there's a peace that happens when you get saved. Your sins are washed away. But there's also a peace that sustains us. You think about Philippians chapter 4 and verse number 7. "The peace of God which passes all understanding." That peace that's unbelievable. That amazing peace that only comes from God. Paul writes to a church and he says, "The peace of God which passes all understanding shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. That's the sustaining peace. That's the peace that it gets you through what you're facing in this life. Because I want to tell you, we face a lot, don't we? I mean, the world hates us today. You may say, well, preacher, the world doesn't hate us. Let me tell you, you just go around and you don't got to be a jerk. There's no cause to be ugly to people, no cause to be a jerk to people. But you just tell people, listen, I just believe the Bible. The Bible says God made them male and female. In the beginning, God created them male and female. And they'll hate you. You say, hey, I just believe the Bible, and Jesus backed it up. Jesus said a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave what? Unto his wife. No commentary necessary. The Bible says it. God said it. I believe it. That settles it. People hate us for that. The world hates us. And sometimes we get discouraged and we deal with all that we face in the world. And this world is fallen. This world is not what it once was in the Garden of Eden. The Bible says all creation groaneth and travaileth in sin. This world is all dealing with the world, the flesh, and the devil. Satan wants to destroy us. Satan wants to mess us up. And you read the book of Job. Satan, the Bible calls him the god of this world. He's not a God like the Lord God. But you remember, with God's permission, the Lord's permission, Satan made Job sick. With God's permission, Satan brought a whirlwind that killed Job's family. With God's permission, Satan caused the enemy to come up and steal all of and capture all of Job's flocks. We deal with all that we deal with from the world, the flesh, and the devil. And we wonder, where is their peace? Brother Ben, I need some peace. I've been saved. My sins are forgiven. I know God has washed away my sin. But Brother Ben, I just need some peace, all that I'm dealing with. But the Bible says there's good news for the Christian. There's a peace that will sustain you. There's a peace that will get you through whatever you face in this life. The Bible says, and you might want to write this one in the margin too, Colossians 3 and verse number 15. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts. Let the peace of God. When you come to that point, you say, preacher, I know that come tomorrow, I'm going to face all kinds of trouble at work, at the schoolhouse, everything. Man, the world, the flesh, and the devil, I'm going to catch all kinds of trouble. But Brother Ben, I know I'm going to let the peace of God rule in my heart. I know that I've been saved. I know my sins have been forgiven. I know that God's never going to leave me. He's never going to forsake me. I know that no matter what happens, His grace is sufficient to get me. That I know that God's got a plan for my life. All things work together for good. Brother Ben, when you think about that you can let the peace of God, that peace that passes all understanding, rule in your hearts. Tony Evans, the great preacher down in Texas, he was trying to describe this to his congregation there. And he said it was like two men, two artists, each one painted a picture. And they were asked to paint a picture just to describe the word peace. Paint a picture just with the word peace. What's that mean to you? And the first artist drew something like some of you've seen many times. He drew a scene of the ocean. And man, the sun is setting down, and you can see the sun setting. It's an evening, and the sun's rays are reflecting across the ocean there. The waves are calm, so tranquil, such a peaceful time. He said, that's what peace means to me. The second artist drew something very different. He drew an ocean too, but this time the waves were roaring. You could just see the waves were tall. You could see he drew, and you could tell by the picture with the trees blowing. The wind was howling. The storm was blowing. Everything that was happening. And the man looked and said, how is this a picture of peace? And he says, look over in the corner. And down in the corner were the rocks. The waves were crashing, but there was a couple of tall rocks there. And right on top of those rocks was a little bird singing. And he says, that's the peace of God. That no matter what storm rages in our life, we know we're going to be all right because of Jesus. Let the peace of God rule in your hearts. The Lord's with you. You're in His hands. Jesus said that nobody, no devil, no demon, no person, no one can pluck us out. Everything's going to be all right because God's going to be with us no matter what. His grace is sufficient. All things work together for good. God's got a plan for our life. And so the peace of God, a sustaining peace, a peace that will get you through whatever you face, that God's with me. God's going to help me no matter what I face. There's saving peace. Our sins are washed away. We're made clean because of the blood of Jesus. There's sustaining peace. God's with me no matter what storm, no matter what trial. I'm in His hands. I'm going to be all right, not because of me, but because of Him. But then back to our text. There's a shareable peace. You notice the verse here in Ephesians 6 and verse 15. Paul's talking about the armor of God, and he uses the analogy of the shoes a Roman soldier would wear. And he says when the Roman soldier's going into battle, he doesn't go barefoot. The rocks may be sharp. But instead he's got his feet shod with leather shoes. And he says in verse 15, as a Christian fighting against the world, the flesh, and the devil, he says, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. He said, as a Christian, be ready. It's kind of like I told you the other Sunday night, a good offense is sometimes the best defense. Be ready to take the gospel to others. Your feet shod with the readiness. Be ready to go and tell others about Jesus. This peace that you have when you got saved. This peace that God has blessed you with, no matter what trouble you face in your life, share that peace with others. The gospel of peace must be shared. Be ready to take the gospel to others. How will people hear? Matter of fact, the other time this phrase, if you do a search in a concordance or you go online with your Bible app and you type in that very phrase, gospel of peace, Paul uses it two different times, right here and then in Romans 10. You remember Romans 10 where Paul says in verse 13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. In verse 14, Paul says, how shall they call if they've not heard? And then he says, how shall they hear if there's not a preacher? And how shall they preach except they be sent? And he talks there in that verse 15 about being sent with the gospel of peace. Take the gospel and tell others about Jesus. We look around and there's so many that's got this war going on in their life. They're struggling with the burden of sin. They're struggling. They're looking, where can I find some satisfaction? Where can I find some hope? Where can I find some peace? This world, everybody knows this world is messed up. This world has gone crazy. And people are looking, where's the peace at? Where can I find some hope for my life? You and I know the answer. The peace is found in Jesus. You know, if you pull out a $20 bill this afternoon and go to the dollar store, you go out to eat at a restaurant and you pull out that $20 bill to pay, you'll notice that Andrew Jackson, pitcher, is on the $20 bill. And Jackson, of course, the president, did a lot of great things, but probably the thing he's most famous for was probably the greatest victory ever, the greatest victory in a battle in all of American history, the Battle of New Orleans, January 8th, 1815. Jackson's down in New Orleans, and the British have got Jackson outnumbered. He's fighting veterans from the Napoleonic Wars. These are men who've been, they beat Napoleon, and now the British Army had sent them over to America to beat our forefathers. Jackson, he's outnumbered facing these veterans from Europe, and he's got all these men from Tennessee, some of your forefathers from Kentucky. They're hiding behind cotton bales and earthworks, armed with Kentucky long rifles. They're outnumbered, outgunned. But the battle went on. It's amazing. After the battle didn't last 30 minutes, the Americans had 71 casualties. The British had over 2,000. Now you think about that. Over 2,000 British soldiers were killed, wounded, or captured. 71 Americans is it. Well, maybe the greatest victory ever in American history. After then, the British had never troubled us again after that. I mean, hey, we're not going to mess with them Americans and their Kentucky rifles. But here's what's amazing about that battle. Some of you know the story. January 8th, 1815, ended the War of 1812. But not really. 15 days earlier, over in Europe, the American ambassadors and the British ambassadors got together and they signed the Treaty of Ghent to end the war. To make peace. The war was already over. That was Christmas Eve, 1814. There was no telephones. There was no internet. There was no telegraph wires then. How do you get news from Europe to England? You put it on a boat, sail all the way across the Atlantic Ocean. And when that battle took place in New Orleans, January 8th, nobody knew Jackson didn't know. The British didn't know. None of the people on either side knew. This was useless. They didn't have to suffer. They didn't have to fight. Peace had already been won overseas. The war was over. And that's kind of how it is in our world, isn't it? People go around and they're struggling in trials and fighting. People don't realize the war's already over. Jesus won the victory. He made peace, what's the Bible say? By the blood of His cross. And now you and I, the Bible says, we are justified by faith. Being justified by faith, we have peace with God. All you and I have to do as Christians is to let others know. We're the hands and feet of Jesus. He's called us to be light. He's called us to be salt. He's called us to be a church. And so, shareable peace. Those people you know, we know people are coming to your mind now who are burdened. They're out there and they're in the mess of sin and they're looking for hope and peace and joy and fulfillment. They'll never find it in the world. But they'll find it in Jesus. He said, I'll give you a drink. You'll never thirst again. Everything this world has to offer, it'll run dry. You'll thirst again. But Jesus said, you take a drink of living water, and it'll last forever. It'll satisfy you. So Christian, share God's peace. Point people to Jesus. If you'll look to Jesus, if you'll trust Jesus, if you'll turn from your sin to the Savior, you can be saved. Our job as believers is to do that, to tell others about Jesus. If you're here, Christian, you're struggling, you remember, you can have that sustaining peace through Christ. He'll get you through whatever you're facing. If you've never been saved, look to Jesus. You can have peace with God, saving faith. There's a great song, and I'll be done with this. Brother Greg, you'll have to look this up. We need to sing it sometime. There's a song just written a few years ago, but it's kind of like a hymn. And many of you will know the song, and it says, His mercy is more. And the chorus says this, every time it repeats it, it says, our sins, which are many, but His mercy is more. Isn't that true? No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, Jesus can give you peace. Cry out to Jesus. Run to Jesus. Our sins are many. My sins were many. My sins are many. But I want to tell you, His mercy is more. You can have peace because of Jesus. Cry out to Jesus. Look to Jesus, and you'll find peace. Let's pray. Father, we thank You for the Word of God that